Welcome to Stupid Money. Not that money is stupid. Most of us would love to have more of it. But sometimes we make stupid decisions with it. You don't have to. This is the show that unpacks how to stop making stupid decisions so you can be smarter with your money and have a happier, fulfilled life. Join us today as we take a look at time management. Welcome back to Stupid Money. I'm Diana, and I'm here with John and Vivian. And Vivian, why don't we pick up with you on what's a crazy, stupid thing we do with our money?
Timeshares.
What about them?
It's stupid to purchase those.
Yeah, don't do it, but the gifts are great.
When they try to get you to sign on,
that's
how they,
yeah.
You
that's
like the
hook.
Gifts.
That's the hook.
That's the best part of the deal,
That's the
huh?
best part of the deal. Just go get the gifts.
John, what about you? What's a crazy, stupid thing we do?
Spending money on electronic gadgets, the latest electronic gadgets.
Gadgets.
I just got to have all these bells and whistles and the bling and everything. It's just...
Most of the time, it's just about being the first one to have it because we're not even utilizing
and then
half
thinking
the features.
It's a necessity.
Yeah.
Half the time,
yeah.
We don't know how to use it.
True that. So our episode today is all time. And the first thing that came to my mind was time equals money.
I thought you might say that, so I brought this along. You talking about this token
yes,
right here?
Yes, absolutely. But token, wait, keep passing it on. If
no,
that's just
I want to keep this one. That,
okay.
You know, this has got to get me to the next point. This is a token of a system. Money is a system. We call this money, but this is a token. In other words, the confidence that I have in this gives it value.
So all of a sudden, the phrase time is money with money equaling value means that how I spend my time reveals what I value.
Exactly. Are you ready for this?
Fire.
Purpose drives values. Values drive goals. Goals drive time. And time drives money.
Whoa. Good thing we have a whole episode to unpack that. But before we do, why don't we catch up with John on the streets of Times Square and find out what people had to say on money.
What do you do to waste time?
I sleep a lot.
I waste time on like trashy TV.
Perhaps common things that young people waste time on, like video games.
Oh, I waste my time on trying to make things perfect that were probably as good as they needed to be long before I get there.
Oh yes, all the time, yeah.
What do you waste time on?
Oh, you know, it's scrollaxing, isn't it? So it's going through Facebook, Twitter.
Social media, and probably school.
What do you waste time on?
I like smoking a lot of weed.
Well, yeah. Does that ever cost you money?
Well, sometimes it do, but I get a way to get high.
Yeah. All right, thanks very much. That's all there is
You're
to
welcome.
It. Does that ever cost you money?
Opportunity cost. All the time.
And what do you try to do about it?
I try to set timers for myself occasionally when I'm working on something at work, or I try to get up and walk away from it.
Because I don't necessarily work as much as I could.
Well, time's money, isn't it? So yeah. So because I'm not doing anything productive, yes, it costs me money. Yes.
What do you waste time on?
Stressing on women.
Okay, say that again.
Stressing on women.
All right. Does that ever cost you money?
Yeah, because I need to spend money on dates for them, buy them clothes, do whatever it takes to just be with them. That's it. Like.
What a way to go. Okay, what do you waste time on?
Well, I like buying a lot of shoes, a lot of Jordans. Feel me?
What kind of shoes?
Jordans.
Okay, play basketball?
Yeah, sometimes I do, but I like to ball out a lot.
That was pretty cool, John. Time and Times Square.
It was. There was enough people there for everybody from all over the world. They were marching, protesting, having fun. They were all wanting to have a good time.
Oh, yeah.
As far as that mantra, Purpose drives values. Values drive goals. Goals drive time. Time drives money. And people will trade money for all of that stuff.
Sometimes, yes. Sometimes, no.
Ooh, it sounds like you have a story.
I do have a story. When I was young, my first job at the bank, I worked in bookkeeping. And bookkeeping, they have deadlines. And we had a deadline. And we had to get statements out. And at the time, it was the computers went down. So it was a Friday. And I knew that they were going to be staying late. And I couldn't do it because I had told them I couldn't work on Sabbath. So when I told them that in my resume, I decided, well, he must have forgotten. And I decided, well, stay at least until you can get your final paycheck, a full day, because he had sent everyone home. And I said, well, I'm just gonna stay so that I can get my full paycheck.
Why did he send them home?
Because they were gonna work at least till midnight.
So he break, did, come
he,
back.
He didn't wanna mm-hmm. he didn't wanna pay overtime. Mm-hmm. And so when everyone were returning, I knew it was time for me to leave. So I walked into my boss's office and I said, well, I'm sorry, I told you when I took this job I couldn't work from sunset Friday to sunset Saturday, so I'm gonna have to leave.
Wow.
And he said, oh, I didn't mean you. And I was shocked, and everyone were watching me as I left because they too wanted to go home. But as I was leaving, it became very quiet and you could hear my footsteps on the towel and you could hear me clicking that time clock. And as I was leaving also, I knew I didn't have a ride home. So I called an elder from the church, and sure enough, he came, he picked me up, and the most beautiful sunset that I've ever seen were coming down just behind the mountains of El Paso.
What an incredible story.
That explains. Purpose drives values, values drive goals, goals drive time, time drives money. Let's say, Vivian, I give you $1,440, and you can spend it any way you want to, but you got to spend it every day. If you don't spend it, you got to give me what's left. You would have a hard time spending that much money every day.
Yes.
We actually have over the long haul.
Yes.
We actually have 1,440 minutes a day. You can't save them for tomorrow. You can't use them in the past. Once they are gone, they are gone. It's not a renewable resource. So we need to treat time with value, and we need to treat money that same way.
So how do we better manage our time?
Well, I found out that there's this Charles Schwab. He has this thing that he does with his employees, that he did with his employees. He brought someone in because he wanted to have an edge over his competitors. And he was a big tycoon that in the steel industry back in 1918.
Okay.
And he brought this guy in named Ivy Lee. And Ivy Lee, he wanted him to help him to better the production because he wanted an edge over his competitors. And he said, help me, what should I do? And he said, well, I can teach you what to do. And he said, all right, how much is going to cost me? He said, what I will do is I will show you how to do it, and if it works, you can pay me what you think is worth.
Interesting.
And if it doesn't work, you don't have to pay me anything. And so he taught his employees the six things. And the six things were simple. You want to know what they were?
I'm dying to hear.
Every day, it was a blank sheet of paper that everyone was supposed to have, and they were supposed to put six things that they were supposed to get done that day. Only six, not eight, not nine, not 10. Just six things, and then they were supposed to prioritize them. And when they did the first thing, they would check it off. The second thing, they would check it off. Whatever they didn't finish that day, it went over to the next day.
So it rolled over.
It rolled over, and then they were only to have six things that day. And each day, the workers did that, and they became a very successful business because of that.
Listing out six items?
Yes.
Only rolling them over when they're done.
I do the six things. When I go into to my office, I'm sitting in front of my computer screen. I have my six things right in front of me.
Really?
Because my day goes haywire, and I always come back to those six things. I've introduced it even to my assistant and my associate.
Time management skills.
It's time management.
Well, let me tell you how much it costs. He wanted to pay, Mr. Schwab wanted to pay him. He paid him $25,000, and that was in 1918.
So it's much more
that
valuable.
That was worth $400,000.
$400,000.
In our time. Yeah.
By the way, there's an app called Six Things. All it is a blank screen. You write down the six things, and if you don't get them done, it rolls them over to the next page.
Oh, brilliant.
It's cool stuff, free.
Wow, these are all super practical tips on time management. Stay tuned for more after this break.
Hi there. On today's Money Hack, we're going to compare the cost of cooking from scratch versus cooking from a muffin mix or buying an already baked muffins from the store. Sometimes there just isn't time to cook from scratch, but when you can, what are the financial savings? That's a great question. Let's find out. I'm going to make my favorite blueberry muffin recipe, but before I do, let's find out how much store-bought muffins will cost. If you head down the baking aisle, you can probably pick up a muffin mix for about $2.50. Adding in the cost of one egg, 12 cents, and tax, 18 cents, we come to $2.80. If we divide by 12 servings per package, we get 23 cents per muffin. Already baked muffins at the store are gonna vary in price, but they will likely cost about 75 cents after tax, though it can be much higher if you buy one at a cafe. Now let's see how that compares to making muffins from scratch. First, let's put together the wet ingredients. We will use one egg, 12 cents, a half a cup of oil, 28 cents, half a cup of sugar, 5 cents, half a cup of orange juice, 13 cents. Then we'll put together the dry ingredients. 2 cups of flour, 5 cents, 2 teaspoons baking powder, 3 cents, 1/4 teaspoon of salt, 1 cent, 1 teaspoon orange rind, which won't cost us anything, and finally, 1 cup of frozen blueberries, 90 cents. The grand total for the entire muffin recipe is $1.57, which is 13 cents a muffin. If I'm cooking for my family, it's not uncommon for us to eat a total of 6 muffins. In one meal, cooking from scratch gives us savings of 60 cents over the box mix and a savings of $3.72 over the store-bought muffins. Obviously, a lot depends on the ingredients you use and the grocery store you shop at. But in general, making muffins from scratch saves a little bit over making them from a box and is about 6 times cheaper than baked muffins from the store. Let's say, during an average week, you could save $20 by cooking from scratch. That may not seem like much, but that adds up to $1,040 a year. Now let's imagine you invest that $1,040 in a Roth IRA, retirement account, every year for 35 years. Based on a conservative historic interest rate of 7%, after 35 years, that account will be worth $153,830, and that's tax-free. Cooking from scratch makes for tasty meals and a lot of health benefits. I can choose to use more whole grains and keep the fat and sugar amounts lower than typically come in pre-made mixes or baked goods. But even if we just look at the financial angle, we can see that cooking from scratch pays off. Thanks for joining us on today's Money Hack.
Speaking of time, it's time for Stewardship for Dummies with Dave and his friend, Cousin Lou. Today, they will talk to us about managing time.
Welcome back to Stewardship for Dummies. This is my friend, Cousin Luke McCoy from Toadsuck, Arkansas.
Cousin Luke the Short.
Be careful with those short jokes.
Is that because some of the cannery in a short?
I'm not saying.
Is it because you're short?
Listen, Cousin Luke, I have a very serious question to ask you.
Whatever it is, I did not do it.
Last week, all you did was complain.
That's because I'm getting tired of doing the same old thing every day.
What do you mean?
Well, it seems all I have to do is the chores, like wash the car, mow the lawn, go to church. It's the same thing, and I never had time to go fishing and catching frogs.
Well, have you ever thought maybe it's your fault you don't have more time for fun?
Not thought neither. I'm as thirsty as a new hare on a mangy dog.
I'm surprised to hear you say that with what happened yesterday.
Now, you leave my task out of this.
You know, you say you have so much, you don't have much time for fun. Could it be because you don't manage your time right?
Well, who else is gonna manage it?
Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. Last week, I overheard you tell one of your friends that you think going to church is a waste of time. Why do you think we go to church?
Where else is gonna catch up in our sleep? Sometimes a sermon is so boring.
Cousin Luke, I'm surprised at you.
Okay, we go to church to hear a good sermon and sing and give a faithful offering.
Well, that is true, and I do hope you listen to the sermon.
Oh, I listen all right. Both ears. One ear to take it in, the other ear to let it out.
I hope you're kidding.
Sure enough am.
So why don't you start planning your day for tomorrow?
Okay, I will. I'll plan it right now. I'm gonna plan to go fishing and catch a North Frogs.
What?
Our guest today, Jason, is from Oklahoma. He is going to be sharing with us his inspirational experience on how to better manage our time. Stay with us. We'll be right back after this break.
Welcome back to Stupid Money. I'm here today with Jason Watts. Jason, thank you for joining us today.
It's my pleasure.
And I understand that you are from Oklahoma.
Yes.
Well, thank you for coming all this way from Oklahoma. It's our pleasure to have you.
I'm enjoying it. Thank you.
Well, we're going to start off this episode that is about time management, talking to you a little bit. But first, I want to get to know you a little bit better. What do you do?
Well, I'm in electrical preventive maintenance sales. That's how I earn a living. But I've been married to my amazing wife, Brandy, for just over 23 years. I have a daughter that's almost 14. Her name's Jaden. And a son, Jager, that is 15 years old.
Okay.
And in our off time, we serve at Hope Retreat Ranch in Choctaw, Oklahoma.
And on this ranch, what type of service are you providing?
Well, we have a lot of different things that we provide. Our mission is to enrich people's lives through nature, health, and horsemanship. We serve the community by offering kids from Votech to come out and be in a mentorship program where they have real world situations that they're put in on being leaders and how to be managers and things like that. And these are kids in Votech that may have some type of a disability, a mental or physical challenge, and they're partnered with older folks, mentors that can lead them in projects. We serve our community through with families or church groups, community organizations. We provide them with a place where they can come out and camp or do socials, just come out on our 50 plus acres. Another thing that we do in service is we have an equine activity program where we serve people with disabilities.
And how does that work? This equine, is that horses, right?
Yes.
So you have that program going on to help disabled children. How does that work out?
Children and adults. This last year we started adults. We're able to serve those with autism, cerebral palsy, those that have sensory disorders, some that are blind, kids and adults with Down syndrome. We're able to use the horses and play games and do different activities that are therapeutic in nature that can help raise their self-esteem, help through different stretching activities and things like that where they're getting therapeutic type things done to them, but you know, it's in a lot more fun environment.
So Jason, that's remarkable. How did you come about to get this ranch?
This was completely God's timing type thing. My wife and I were at church one Sabbath and we were asked to meet this gentleman at a property. We were given a location. He met us there and basically gave us the keys to this 30 acres and said, you know, my wife and I, our families wanted to use this for ministry and we'd like for you guys to be involved. So he handed me the keys. 2 weeks later, we were blessed with 7 horses. And at that point, we just started to, you know, ask God, what do you want us to do? What plans do you have for us? And through research and time and study, how can we use it to minister to people? That's how we've come up with the therapeutic activities for those with disabilities.
Now, did you grow up on a ranch or did you always want to be on a ranch?
Ever since we were married, my wife did, ever since we were married, we've talked about living out in the country, but it was always we weren't going to go into debt to do it. So 18 years later, after we were married, God opened up the doors for us to move out into the country, to live there, someone else's property, and to help build this vision that's been given to us.
Now, Jason, this episode is about time management. How in the world do you have time to do all of that when you told me you have another job? How do you have time to do this with the ranch and the job you have?
Well, what I've come to realize and to learn is to do things in God's timing. You know, a lot of things that those of us that serve, we want to do a lot of good things, but I've come to realize that not all things are good for me to do. So aligning myself with God's timing and really involving Him in what is it that you want me to do? There's things that I've had to learn over the years to turn down and say no to that are good in nature. But if I did everything, it would be at the sacrifice of other things as well. So there's things that I would have to sacrifice. It may be my time with God, my time with my family. I've realized that they're my support group. The time that I spend with my wife is so valuable. And with my two teenage kids, they need my time. And if I'm being pulled away with all these other things, be it church activities or mentoring others, even work at the ranch, there's a balance that I have to have in there, or I've realized it's outside of God's will. I don't think He wants me to do these good things and sacrifice the things that He's put me in charge of and to be a steward of as well.
Jason, are there any Bible verses that sort of sums up what you're telling me here today?
Psalms 127:1 can sum it up. It says, "Unless the Lord builds this house, those who labor do so in vain." And we've seen that work over and over out at the ranch and in my life personally as well.
So that's a great scripture. So unpack that for me. How have you seen that actually work?
Man, it goes back all the way to even the property that was purchased was in God's timing. It was bought for over $100,000 less than what it would normally go for. We needed buildings out there on the property. We got them set and final inspection was given. The inspector who inspected those buildings came out 2 weeks later and said, "Hey, guess what? I realized that these buildings aren't allowed in city property, but I've already given you the inspection. So you guys are, you know, you can have these buildings here." The utility power that came in, God lined it up so that we got utility poles set, transformers set, all the power, and it didn't cost us a dime. We needed a road that came back into our property over 1,400 foot long, and it was going to cost us tens of thousands of dollars to have that road put in. God blessed us with a dump truck and asphalt. It didn't cost us a dime for any of that asphalt. Just over and over and over again, even with my wife and I, 18 years later, after praying, if God wanted us to be out in the country, He would put us there. God put us out there. And we were able to, even when we moved out there, we were able to rent our house out in town, pay that mortgage off, and God did all of it. We didn't manipulate the situation at all. And we can do that, but it wears us out when we end up working against God sometimes.
So you were just following God's lead.
Oh, for sure. And there are other projects that we have, indoor arena, you know, cabins out there, all different these things. And rather than allowing it to stress us out on where are we going to come up with these resources, we've decided as a group and as a body to just sit back and wait on God.
Well, what's your favorite part about all of this at the ranch?
The thing that brings me the biggest joy and the biggest smiles, I think, are going to be those times where the kids come out that have disabilities. And for example, a little girl that, you know, she's only being able to walk with a walker, and to get her off of the horse, and after several weeks of this type of activity, have her get off the horse and walk on her own. Wow. To see kids that have never said a word before, to say whoa or walk on, to see kids that don't communicate well, but yet they'll verbalize what they want by tapping on the saddle horn to go. We get to see a lot of firsts out at the ranch with these kids that are challenged, and to see the joy and of what the parents go through, and to see the joy and the accomplishments that the kids make, it makes it all worth it.
Makes it all worthwhile.
Without a
doubt.
That
reminds me of the text, "The joy of the Lord is my strength." For Jason, I thank you so much for being here with us today and sharing your story with us. Blessings to you and your family and the work that you're doing, and we pray that that ministry will flourish even more.
Thank you so much.
We'll be right back after this break.
Welcome back to Stupid Money. What a wonderful story. He was so real on his journey and learned to trust God more intentionally with his time.
It was good. You know, if you waste your money, you're just only out some money. But if you waste your time, you've lost part of your life. That's why I like Ecclesiastes 3, verse 1. It says, "To everything there's a season, a time for every purpose under heaven." We need to make good use of our time.
This whole episode has been on challenging us to use our time wisely and to learn to trust God more intentionally in our lives. I hope you join us again on another episode of Stupid Money.